In my last video, I presented the Vive Pro 2, of which I thought would be the top-notch headset nowadays. Well, I was wrong. Completely wrong. I just had an eye on the consumer market, but VR headsets for professionals are way further. So I reached out for the best available pro headset on the market, which claims to have a human eye resolution. And thankfully, Varjo gave me a device for a few days. In the next few minutes, I will show you how it changes our Simracers world. Welcome to TrackTime TV, your channel for high-end sim racing. There are currently two headsets available from Varjo. The VR3, which is a pure VR headset, and the XR3, which has additional cameras for AR solutions. Varjo gave me the XR3, but I will turn off the cameras because there currently is no use case for them in sim racing. And with turned off cameras, the XR3 is actually the same like the VR3, only 50 grams heavier. So everything touched in this review will be the same for the VR3. First of all, the bad news. The Varjo headsets will only be sold to companies for professional use. And the price tag is, let's say, it's not a bargain. The VR3 costs 3,195 euros and the XR3 is at 5,495 euros. But this is only the hardware. To run this headset, you will additionally need to buy a subscription, which is at another 795 euros a year. The 3-year subscription is at 2,095 euros, so if you want to use this headset for 3 years, the VR3 is more than 5k. But you also have to run a company to place the order. However, there are some freaks, or better say, enthusiasts, who have bought this headset for gaming. And since the headset is fully compatible to Steam VR, there is no hindrance to do so. But first things first. This thing is a beast technical-wise. The VR3 has 4 displays, 2 displays for each eye. It has 1 low-res display, and low-res means for Varjo 2880 by 2720, which is more than the Reverb G2 has. And the G2 is already really sharp. This low-res display is only for the peripheral area of the screen. Inside this display is another one, a smaller with a very high pixel density and a resolution of 1920 by 1920. Resolution-wise, this doesn't sound too much, but it's the pixel density that counts. And with this trick, you have the maximum resolution in the center of the display. The pixel density of this small display is 70 ppd, which means 70 pixels per degree. Anything above 60 ppd is human eye resolution, which is absolutely insane. The outer display still has a density of 30 ppd, which again is more than the Reverb G2 has. But even those of you who know how sharp the G2 already is can barely imagine how crystal clear the center of this display is. One would think that you can see the border and of the inner display, but you can't. The gap between these two displays, the inner one and the outer one, is absolutely seamless. And here is another catch. To operate this beast, you also need a beast of computer, at least an RTX 3080 GPU and an i9-9900K. The headset needs to be connected with 2 cables and needs 2 display ports. It also has 2 power units and therefore the cable is pretty heavy. Putting on the headset, you recognize it's pretty heavy as well. Comfort is a very personal thing. My 2 TrackTime business partners, Henning and Philip, both tested the headset as well, and they felt very comfortable. So it's very dependent of the shape of your head, size and shape of your nose, etc. For me personally, the headset is not very comfortable. I always feel a pretty strong pressure of the face foam and on the forehead. Not very annoying, but I feel a bit of discomfort. This is also due to the weight of the headset. However, the VR3 is somewhat lighter than the XR3, so with the VR3 it should be a bit better. My head at least pretty much feels squeezed in, and the headset is still not very firmly attached. If I try to tighten the dial on the forehead a bit too much, the headset suddenly drops down. So there's really a thing to improve. And another catch, it takes pretty long to put it on. You always have to adjust both dials. This is a pretty huge drawback for me, since in sim racing I have to put off the headset off pretty often. As you can see, there are no speakers. Both Varjo headsets, the VR3 and the XR3, come without headphones. So either you enjoy the sound of your 5.1 hi-fi, or you have to buy a separate headphone. For me, this is a big disadvantage. Using separate headphones is warmer, more weight, and especially with motion sims, it is even more likely that the headset will slip out of place. But now let's come to where the Varjo shines. And it shines bright. Almost every single disadvantage of VR is eliminated with the VR3. For instance, glare. Glare is one of the most criticized topics of VR headsets. Some have more glare, some less. But every VR headset I know has glare. For the Varjo, this topic is pretty fast to discuss. There simply is none. Period. Another thing is distortion. There are complaints about distortion in some games for the Varjo. And I also experienced massive distortion in iRacing, but this was not Varjo's fault. After changing the setting, fix get projection raw bug to 1 in the renderer dx11.ini, the distortion was completely gone. Some users still complained about distortion with the VR3, but with my XR3, there is no distortion at all. So there might be some little differences between those two headsets. It also has been reported by other users that after a while of usage, the display starts tearing, and mine did as well. Some call it water ripple effect, and that's the best description. It looks like the picture in the outer screen is washed away. I experienced it several times and it made me feel dizzy. With my Vive Pro 2, I don't really like the rings coming from the Fresnel lenses. With a Varjo, well, there must be a reason for the hefty price tag of that headset. One reason might be the small production numbers, another the high resolution screens, but for sure the lenses aren't cheap as well, because they are simply great. There are no rings, as you know from the Fresnel lenses, but you still have a wide field of view. I never measure the field of view. There have been lots of discussions about FOV, so I just compare it to my other headsets. To me, the FOV seems to be slightly smaller than this of the Vive Pro 2. Which is totally okay for me, since the whole area is sharp. There is a little bit of distortion in the edges, which makes some kind of fisheye effect, but in iRacing this doesn't bother me at all. And there is also no hassle with IPD adjustment anymore. With my former headsets, I always wasn't sure if I had adjusted the right IPD. And to be honest, never felt that much difference when I changed the position of the lenses. The Varjo has an automatic IPD adjustment. Every time you put the headset on, you hear the little motors adjusting the lenses exactly to your IPD. It takes about 2 to 3 seconds, and the lenses are absolutely perfect adjusted. Another topic that is discussed in every review are the blacks. Well, I've already seen darker blacks in some OLED headsets, but for sim racing, this isn't a big issue, especially there's absolutely no glare anymore. A very cool feature for the Varjo is the active cooling system, which is a huge plus for your sim races. Even at high temperatures of more than 30 degrees Celsius, I didn't have problems with fog. With all other headsets, I had problems with foggy lenses from time to time, and this can be extremely annoying while you are racing and causing to fail a race. How did the VR3 work with racing simulators? For most racing titles, the Varjo just worked like any other headset. But I experienced some trouble with SteamVR. I got error messages and couldn't get the headset working again. But this also seems to be not an issue of the Varjo, but SteamVR. And some helpful users told me to plug the headset off, restart SteamVR, and plug the headset in again. After that, it worked like the charm again. Reportedly, this also happens to the Pimax, so you cannot blame Varjo for that. Unfortunately, I couldn't get it running properly with Race Room. Maybe there's a way to get it working, but it ran only in a very low resolution and with very low frames per second. With every other simulation, it worked absolutely flawlessly. One of my biggest concerns was performance. Since this is absolutely mission critical for racing sims, stutter will kill immersion, and due to the ultra high resolution, my suggestion was that you would have to wait to the release of the next GPU generation. Reverb G2 and Vive Pro 2 already need the full performance of a 3090. But surprisingly, the Varjo performs almost exactly like the G2 and the Vive Pro 2. I don't know what kind of magic the Varjo guys used, but it works. I tested several simulations and the result was performance-wise pretty the same like with the Vive Pro 2 and the G2. iRacing works absolutely fine and smooth. The experience is absolutely incredible. I had the smoothest picture ever, but only as long as you can keep the 90 FPS. You have to adjust settings, switch off HDR, and lower some other settings. If you drop under 85 FPS, you will get a tearing picture that I already mentioned. So just use lower settings and wait for the next generation of GPUs to enjoy the VR3 to its full extent. But the sharpness of the picture, the foresight are absolutely insane and absolutely comparable to reality. You can see signs and cars in the far absolutely clear, which is a massive improvement for the immersion. Even if the FOV is not the biggest one as, for instance, compared to the Pimax, the picture is absolutely sharp from edge to edge. For me, this is way more important than having an 180 degrees FOV, but only 50 degrees that are really sharp. I didn't record any through the lens footage, but if you like to see some through the lens videos, follow the link in the upper right corner. Next Gen VR also tested the VR3 and made some really cool stuff that give you an idea of how superior the picture is. For iRacers, let's give me an example. Take your VR headset, sit back in your Porsche and lean back. Can you see the Stuttgart in the Porsche logo? Not. With a Varjo, you can see it crystal clear. With a Vive Pro 2, I needed to get as close as possible to the wheel to see that there is a writing at all. Maybe you now get an idea of how sharp and detailed the picture is. As always, Automobilista 2 worked perfect and looked awesome. The colors are a bit candy-ish, but when you come from the gray looking iRacing, everything looks like candy. Overall, it's just overwhelming, runs super smooth, and also the foresight is simply like in reality. There really is no comparison to this headset. If you thought the latest generation of VR headset were good, you were wrong, like I was. You will be blown away by the clarity, the ultra high resolution, and the overall impression of the Varjo. So the question is, should you go and get it? Is the Varjo worth the money? Despite its drawbacks, for racers with static simulators, it's really the best experience you can get. And I think it will remain so for a pretty long time. So if you can afford it and are a real addict, go and get it. If I hadn't a motion sim, I would have already purchased it. But with a motion sim, I still had to make up my mind. You are sweating like mad in the motion sim, and with the additional headphones, it even gets warmer. Also, the weight of the headset is more noticeable when driving with motion turned on. However, I got used to it. And I also forgot about the head strap, which is not ideal for my head. Now, I tell you what. After switching back to a G2 yesterday, I placed the order. There's simply no way back. The Varjo is simply the way to go. You have to bear in mind that this is not a consumer headset, and there will be some more difficulties to get it running properly for your use case. But what I can say, the customer service is superb. They respond during minutes and are very friendly and helpful. I also know a guy whose headset was replaced immediately due to a dead pixel. So, there are two major drawbacks for this headset. First, you have to open up a business so you can buy it. Secondly, you have to sell a kidney to afford it. But honestly, who needs two kidneys? Thanks for watching this video. Hit the subscribe button if you don't want to miss out the latest and hottest stuff for simracers.